should he even care? Folks, you are listening to the flagship show of the Radulich and Broadcasting Network, the one that started it all, and boy, am I glad to be back. This is The Long Road to Ruin, and I am your host, the mandated reporter, and frankly, I'm mortified, Mr. Mark Radulich. It's been a hell of a week. I'm not going to go off on a tangent, because then somebody on a WrestleCast will, a year later, never let me forget it. But I will say that it was a rough week, but things are back to normal now. My family is home. Everyone is healthy and safe. And that leaves me ready, willing, and able to do frivolous and marvelous things like talk about movies on a podcast with my buddies. And that's what we're going to do. So tonight, since this is Avengers week, and I've missed not one but two shows, I'm actually excited to talk about anything, something, Avengers. And that means tonight is the Iron Man trilogy. Yes, the one that started it all in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Robert Downey Jr. playing Robert Downey Jr. in a cheap suit. I'm just kidding. Here to help me do all of that, he is the wordsmith, Mr. Sean Comer. How do you do, sir?
Hi, everybody. I'm Sean. You're not. And tonight's show is brought to you with limited commercial interruptions. By limited, I mean none. Thanks to Vandalay Industries and Nick Diaz Cat Jitsu. Call 219-634-5789 for your free introductory week of lessons for your furry little cuddleway champion.
I saw an article recently that apparently if you've got a kid with asthma or something, just not very athletic child, the perfect sport for them is jujitsu. And I thought that was pretty cool.
Martial arts. Chuck Norris did not lie to you. Did you doubt Chuck when he made that shitty movie with Joe Piscopo and Jonathan Brandis? Yeah?
No.
Did you? And the great Mako? Oh, did you? Did you doubt him? Well, then fuck you. That's what you get. Because Chuck didn't lie. Martial arts beats asthma.
Nobody doubts Chuck Norris. All right. Let's get into, let's leave all this silliness behind and get into the movies tonight. So, the Marvel Cinematic Universe, yeah? There was a time and a place where Marvel was trying to make some cash, and they rented out their properties to other movie studios. To this day, some of them are still owned by 20th Century Fox. They've got the X-Men and the Fantastic Four and all of the associated characters that they're in. Sony got Spider-Man, they made a trilogy, then they tried again with two more movies, and then they said, fuck it, take it back. we don't know what we're doing, and we somehow can't protect our emails. But with the characters that Marvel had left and they continued to get back from these other studios, they went out to create a Marvel Cinematic Universe, and then along the way Disney bought them. And the motion picture that started it all, the one that got the ball rolling, the one that set up what would eventually become the Avengers and then lead into Phase 2, which is now concluding with the Avengers, Age of Ultron, and Ant-Man, was Iron Man, starring Robert Downey Jr., Gwyneth Paltrow, Jeff Bridges, and Terrence Howard. And, you know, back when Iron Man came out in 2008, it was a tricky business. There was a spotty record, especially with Marvel films, not so much with DC. DC had a decent track record, especially early on with the Christopher Reeve Supermans and the first two Tim Burton Batman movies, which we discussed at length on this show. You can go back and listen to them in the archives. But Marvel has had a rough time. And to come up with an entire cinematic universe and create essentially a series of movies that would be chapters in a bigger story was an enormous task and a huge risk. But they had to start off on the right foot. If Iron Man had sucked, if Robert Downey Jr. wasn't able to live up to the character and wasn't able to keep himself healthy and sober, this whole thing could have unraveled before it even began. But it didn't. They successfully put out the picture. It did oodles of money. People loved now I don't think you can even separate Robert Downey Jr. from Tony Stark, and we can talk about maybe why that is in just a few minutes. But Iron Man and this is why we're talking about it tonight, is the most important trilogy in the Marvel Cinematic Universe right now, because without it, there wouldn't be one. Sean, I want to get some of your initial thoughts and any history you might have researched on how we got to the very first Iron Man.
You know what, guys? First off, come at me, neckbeards. Yeah, that's right. I fell in love with this character thanks to the movie. By all means, bring it on, fuckers. And that's in part because they did such an outstanding job through and through across the entire first movie of really making sure that they got right down to the core of modernizing what Stan Lee envisioned for the characters. And that is, if I may quote him, quote, "I think I gave myself a dare. It was the height of the Cold War. The readers, the young readers, if there was one thing they hated, it was war. It was the military. So I got a hero who represented that to the 100th degree. He was a weapons manufacturer. He was providing weapons for the army. He was rich. He was an industrialist. I thought it would be fun to take the kind of character that nobody would like, none of our readers would like, and shove him down their throats and make them like him. And he became very popular." And that's really pretty much what they did, was when they sought out to make this the opening salvo in really launching the Marvel Cinematic Universe, they really went in a different direction than any other adaptation of a Marvel movie had. And that was the idea that, for one thing, they got a really extremely talented writer-director on board in the form of Jon Favreau, who's also in the movie as Tony Stark's chauffeur and assistant, Happy Hogan. They got Robert Downey Jr. on board to play Stark. And as you pointed out, yeah, you know, screw your Starkiness, your snarkiness, yes. Robert Downey Jr. was basically playing Robert Downey Jr. However, he really had the brilliant idea in coming into the movie of really telling Kevin Kevin Fahugukwa that if you really want to get to the heart and soul of Tony Stark, and you really want to figure out how to modernize this guy, there's one thing you got to do, and that is we got to go talk to Elon Musk. Because they based it really very strongly on somebody who had not only that kind of talent, that kind of genius, that kind of vision, but somebody who just naturally was that kind of tireless, ambitious, technical vanguard, and sort of applied that as the foundation upon which they would build all the other traits that make Tony, you know, the excess, the alcoholism, the narcissism, and what resulted was really an incredibly grounded movie that, thankfully, Kevin Fraggle Rock and the rest of Marvel and the rest of Disney have been able to build upon, such that it's almost not really like so much they're making movies anymore, so much as it's almost like they're just making really comics on this incredibly grand multimedia scale, because everything builds off each other. Everything is cumulative. Everything comes together, and to really understand the entire universe, you can get some grasp of it by sort of just watching a Thor movie here, or just watching Captain America there, or just watching Iron Man, or even just watching the Avengers. But you're not really going to fully get absolutely everything that's going on unless you just dive in whole hog and you really immerse yourself in these characters. But the good news there is, as I'm sure we're going to be talking about for the next two movies, Mark, is the fact that they did create characters that you could seriously engage with and involve yourself with and kind of feel a connection along.
I think that's why, as one of the pillars of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, throughout Phase 1, Phase 2, and Phase 3, Tony Stark works as a character. Because what we have here is a guy, you know, is a man of privilege, a man of great intelligence and wealth, and he's just, you know, wallowing in it. I mean, on the one hand, you know, before Afghanistan, if you look at the totality of all three movies, you know, flashbacks included, you know, what you have is a guy who obviously is a talented genius and is trying to create things that are that he believes will make the world better. At the same time, here is a guy not thinking about the cost of his legacy and what it's doing to the world, and he's, you know, enjoying his fame, as it were. It isn't until the incident in Afghanistan, which sets the whole thing going, where he nearly dies and has to be kept alive by putting in essentially an electromagnet, I believe, in his chest. A mini arc reactor. It isn't until then that he has to come face to face with exactly what his legacy is and what it should be. And the thing of it is that it's that struggle, that internal struggle with Tony, carried throughout all of Phase 1, Phase 2, and will inform Phase 3 as we get into Civil War. Tony is a very damaged and complex character, and I like the fact that Marvel hit a bullseye, I think, with playing the amount of damage and internal strife, while not creating, as some might, let me phrase it this way: people complained about Spider-Man because he whined too much. They didn't go that far. Okay, and while I disagree with those people who criticized Andrew Garfield's Spider-Man, my point is they didn't make him, he isn't Macbeth here. He isn't so totally depressed and struggling that he becomes not a fun character to watch. On the other hand, they didn't make it, you know, he isn't just out there being a superhero and there's no internal strife going on at all. You know, they really found a nice place in the middle where they could keep the movies upbeat and fun, but there's still dimensions and layers and things for people to sink their teeth into and come away with the fact that these are real people struggling with real problems in a fantastic universe.
You know what?
And that, I
by all means, here's where I'm quite possibly going to end up straying a little bit into my own personal socio-political beliefs, and quite frankly, I don't care because my beliefs are what they are. What I love about Tony is the fact that while he does have his eyes open at one point and realize that he could leave, as he puts it, a greater legacy behind than things that just blow up, the simple fact is, even then, he refuses to see exceptionalism and his own ambition and his own gifts as necessarily being bad things. He refuses to apologize for being great at what he does. He refuses to bemoan his excellence. It's something that's really, and that even now today, even decades after Stan Lee and Jack Kirby first created the character, it still persists as this whole ridiculous self-loathing American cultural trope of you should have to apologize for being good at something, or you should have to apologize if you're good at something and you're not handing over a hefty chunk of the fruits of your labor to somebody else who did absolutely fuck all, something roughly the size of a single fecal coliform molecule, to earn any stake to it or any claim to it whatsoever. He's still going out there, and he's still trying to make the world a better place. But he also sees nothing wrong with, well, why should I not be rewarded? Why should I not profit from it?
I think the greatest part about that, though, is that along the way he keeps screwing it up. He creates the Iron Man armor and it gets abused. He gets into these situations that gets the people around him put in direct danger. He ends up creating Ultron. You know, that's sort of the legacy of Tony Stark, is essentially, you know, I tried to do good and created monsters every step of the way.
Yeah, but you know what? The simple fact is no, it hasn't been perfect every single step of the way. He's not 100% altruistic. Personally, I like that he's not Captain America. I like that he's not I like that he's not Superman. One of the things I've always found fascinating about him is the fact that the main difference between him and Lex Luthor is Lex Luthor is the kind that he creates a cure for cancer, but by no means is he going to put it out there because, you know, it's not just that he altruistically wants a better, happier, healthier world. It's that he wants to rule and hold sway over a better, happier, healthier world. Kind of like the Kingpin in Daredevil's Netflix series. It's the difference between Tony and, say, okay, Oliver Queen. That's another good one. Oliver Queen is a character that, while he's often entertaining, can sometimes just be so obnoxiously proto-hippie. You just kind of, after a while, or I do anyway, after a while, I start reveling in him getting his ass kicked. because I just don't want to fucking listen to it anymore. Tony, on the other hand, I relate to that because it kind of strikes kind of near and dear to me because I'm also somebody who in the last couple of years has had to realize, okay, you've got a lot of talent. You've got a lot you could do, and you're pissing it away. And there's a little sense there that along the way, when you're trying to kind of build back up from that and you're trying to do the right thing, yeah, you do the wrong things along the way sometimes, even when you're well-meaning. And it isn't just this ridiculous 180-degree turnaround. Like I said, the whole Oliver Queen thing. It's not just, no, you don't just turn everything around and around because you have an epiphany and every mistake you've made just goes away. No, sometimes you do have to keep facing them, and sometimes you do keep making mistakes, but you can't let it stop you from trying to move forward and from trying to find the path that you're convinced is out there. And it's why I'm trying to remember who it was that I first had this conversation with, because I swear I've had it with two people. I think I had it with my good buddy Cole Marintet, and also with our wonderful title card artist, Ben Colon. And that is that one thing the MCU has done is it's taken these classic Marvel superheroes, but they haven't been making just strictly superhero movies. They've taken them and used them as platforms and as framing devices for very different kinds of stories. With the Iron Man movies, you've got the evolution of a very flawed, hedonistic, but brilliant egotist who all of a sudden realizes there's a lot more that I could be doing and there's a lot of wrongs that I have to undo. And over the course of these three movies, he's always kind of struggling against that current. He's always faced with, as he'll say in the third movie, with another demon he's raised. But he never lets it stop him. In a movie like, say, Thor, you've got themes of forging your own identity in the face of your heritage and kind of what's expected. It's almost kind of nature versus nurture in a way. In Captain America, you've got the story of what really makes a hero. Is it the powers? Is it the superhuman abilities? Is it being able to do things that normal men can only dream of ever being able to do? Or is it something that all those things only augment because it's either with somebody or it isn't? So that's kind of why I'm able to watch the first Iron Man movie and read a lot of the comics and kind of internalize that and realize, okay, this part really isn't so far-fetched.
Yeah, I said it's a fantastic world, the Marvel Cinematic Universe. You know, it's filled with gods and you know, futuristic technology and, you know, crazy powers and whatnot. But that never gets in the way of the fact that these are still human beings that we're dealing with real problems, and, you know, and flaws in their personality. And Iron Man really sets the tone for all of that throughout the Marvel Cinematic Universe, for all of the different heroes. Like, you really can't think of one that wouldn't fall under that description. So the plot is as follows. He's in Afghanistan. He's promoting the Jericho missile for the military to buy. That's what he's doing there. And along the way, his convoy gets attacked by the Ten Rings. They want him and another scientist to build a Jericho missile for them. As I said before, Tony is injured in the attack, and he has shrapnel heading towards his heart. So the first thing they do is they build a small arc reactor to power the electromagnet to keep the shrapnel from killing him. Then they take that same arc reactor and use it to power a suit of armor so that they can escape. Yinsen ends up dying, but Tony Stark gets away. And then it's off to improve on the original clunky classic design of the Iron Man outfit. So our middle chapter deals with a couple of different things. One, Tony realizes that the weapons that he's making, he can't control where they're ever going to end up. While the intention is to sell them to quote-unquote the good guys, as he'll be reminded of in this movie and others again and again and again, anybody can get a hold of his stuff and use it to kill Americans. So he decides that Stark Industries, the weapons manufacturer, is now going to be Stark Industries the something else, because he no longer wants to make weapons. What he doesn't know is that his partner, played by Jeff Bridges, Obadiah Stane, is actually in cahoots with the Ten Rings. But in the meantime, before he finds any of that out, Obadiah Stane is trying to get him to not go crazy and give up making weapons. This is where we meet Gwyneth Paltrow's character, the assistant Pepper Potts, who will become his love interest and all that, but that's later on. So, as I said, along the way, Tony works on creating the Iron Man suit, improving upon it. That takes a little bit. And then he goes right back after the Ten Rings again, and he wipes them out pretty easily. Pushes Obadiah Stane to take more of an involved effort into dealing with Tony. He builds the Ironmonger suit, and they end up in a fight. They nearly kill Pepper. Iron Man eventually defeats him and announces to the world, despite much to S.H.I.E.L.D.'s chagrin, who is introduced in this movie, that he is, in fact, Iron Man, which is different from the comic book. In the comic book, Iron Man, he didn't admit initially that he was Iron Man. He said that Tony Stark said that Iron Man was his bodyguard. But that's kind of the way comic books were back in the, you know, 60s and 70s. Everybody had a secret identity, which is what made Civil War so interesting at the time, was, you know, dealing with that secret identity issue. But right out of the gate, they decided that he was going to embrace this thing as part of his character, and he announced that he is, in fact, Iron Man. And in the post-credits scene, we have our introduction of Samuel Jackson as Nick Fury, who tells him that he's not the only superhero in the world, and then he wants to discuss the Avengers Initiative. So there's your first, you know, step towards the Marvel Cinematic Universe. What was that?
I'm sorry, but I love that moment. At the same time, I just also kind of want to always dub in a dun dun dun.
So we have our first step towards the making of the super movie, our really first super movie in America, as far as various superheroes all in one movie, The Avengers. I don't have a whole lot to say about this movie. I think Iron Man 2 generates more of a discussion. So we'll quickly just kind of go over the characters. The plot of the thing is fine. It's as straightforward as anything else. You know, Obadiah Stane is your prototypical backstabbing villain. You know, Pepper Potts, that's played by Gwyneth Paltrow, is fine. You know, she's not quite... I would say she's better than Adrian, though, so there are times where she gets to be a bit of a nag and she starts going in that direction. And Jon Favreau's fun. You know, I get by the third movie, I get annoyed with the everybody talking over everybody else delivery of dialogue. But it's much more toned down in this first movie. Anything else you want to discuss here as far as plot or characters, anything worth talking about here?
It's absolutely superb. You even found a way to make Gwyneth Paltrow bearable, and I'm sure she took the money and bought mini limes, so very many limes with all of the Marvel money. Enjoy the limes, Gwyneth. Enjoy the limes. Jeff Bridges is really excellent as a just mustache twirly enough villain, but also, again, kind of looking at it maybe a little bit allegorically, a symbol of those people that anybody who's ever really trying to make a change and turn a corner has to deal with, who will always, always just be trying to drag them back into that old life. Man, you're right. There's really not much else to say except that it's also the movie that sets the whole Iron Man trilogy up as being, as having the rhythm and the feel of a very slick modern tech thriller. That's its identity as much as the Thor movies have so far been a lot of high fantasy. For the most part, as much as the first Captain America was just a good old-fashioned Raiders of the Lost Ark style action romp, Nazis included, and as much as Guardians of the Galaxy was just arguably one of the greatest space operas of all time, topping a good half the Star Wars movies and other properties up to this point. So it was the start of not just Marvel taking a hold of their own properties and doing right by their own characters and making them each distinct. In other words, they're not making everybody Batman. But it was also the start of giving each movie kind of its own feel, kind of its own little subgenre to stick to. And I love that. I love that. It beats the hell out of even, okay, DC bagging aside, it even beats the hell out of how Fox notoriously does the same thing. The movies all feel the same. They all read about the same way. You can just kind of watch it, and I could show you a movie and just skip the credits, and, you know, you could probably just tell, yeah, that's a 20th Century Fox take on Marvel, just from the way it's shot, approached, cast, the whole ball of wax. So Iron Man was a great start for a character that really wasn't necessarily all that familiar to a lot of mainstream. I talk good. I talk pretty tonight. Watermelons. It's a great start to really reinventing a lot of their properties. And, yeah, it was a fantastic build to pioneering history-making crossover. Now, the question is, would they be able to top it, Mark, with the second movie?
The second movie is generates the most controversy, the most conversation, and is derided by a lot of people. It also had, I think, the heaviest lifting to do. This was like the direct precursor to the Avengers. I mean, Iron Man 3 has the benefit of happening after the Avengers. And therefore it had a lot more room to breathe. It didn't necessarily need to get Tony Stark anywhere. You know, it could just be its own story, and they would pick things up where they needed to later on. And there was also more movies ahead of it to move Tony along if they needed it. Iron Man 2, however, like I said, it had to be the next chapter in the Iron Man story. It had to introduce more S.H.I.E.L.D. members. It had to get him closer to the Avengers. It's a very schizophrenic picture. I don't think it deserves as much hate as it's gotten. I mean, there are reviewers out there that think this is the worst piece of shit Marvel's ever done and kind of stand on top of it when they are criticizing the studio as not making movies, but rather making, you know, chapters in a book or something. You know, there's just a lot of criticism that has followed this movie, and I think it's a little unfair. After rewatching it recently in preparation for this show, I think my biggest gripe about this movie is the most important thing that needs to happen is that Tony needs to figure out how to save his own life. And the plot devices they give him in order to do that are pretty weak and ridiculous. Marvel has, unfortunately, this one big flaw with a lot of their movies, and that is sometimes they move things a little too quickly, and you're like, wait, how did we get here so fast? They have this problem with Age of Ultron, where Ultron, you know, is birthed and immediately going to kill humanity in a matter of seconds, and it's like, wait, what? How did we slow down? It's the same thing here. You spend an hour building up Tony falling to pieces because of his imminent death, and then you introduce him to Nick Fury, and you reveal that Natasha is the Black Widow, and then like, here's stuff. Look it over. It was your dad's. And then suddenly, he has this sort of like crisis where he goes to Pepper and wants to apologize for essentially being a jackass, and she walks out on him, and he happens to see a map, or rather a model of the city that his father wanted to design, and he goes and immediately jumps from that to, huh. That's the outline for the missing element that's going to replace the palladium in my arc reactor. Ta-da!
It is. Oh, okay, I'm sorry. I'm with you that Marvel 2 really gets... Marvel 2.
That is my one big criticism. My only other thing is I actually think Sam Rockwell's character is retarded in this movie. I mean, like, functionally retarded. I actually think he's got a developmental disorder. More on that a bit. That is my biggest problem, is that the thing that you needed to get the third act going is so stupid and convoluted and comes out of the left fucking field that
One nice thing I can say about the Marvel movies is that when it comes to plot development, they are, relatively speaking, fairly low on the bullshit. But that moment with the map is just the moment of, okay, this is my trip on the fuck you train to Nope Town.
I mean, like, I got to get this out because they were on the right track. When Samuel Jackson gives him the shot in the neck, or rather Natasha does, and says, your father was XYZ and you need to live up to him, and here's all of his notes and books and everything, look it over and you'll find the answers. Mm-hmm. What was the point of any of that if essentially the answers were found in Pepper's office? No, I mean, if Tony doesn't fucking give up on his father's notes and go, you know, throw himself on Pepper's tender mercies, none of the rest of that film ever happens. And I'm wondering if anyone bothered to read the script and figure that out.
It truly is. It's a moment akin to watching Adam West and Burt Ward figure out one of the Riddler's riddles in the 60s Batman series.
Those made sense.
That's about how much goddamn sense it makes.
I know you hate the show, but there's an episode of The Big Bang Theory where they figure out that Indiana Jones is completely immaterial to the plot of Raiders of the Lost Ark. It was one of those moments for me. It was like, wait, what? How did none of what you just did made any sense and has no effect on what we were doing in the movie. The point of the whole point of that scene in the diner is to establish somewhat of a friendship between Nick Fury and Tony Stark, and to say, you know, sort of a Mickey to Tony's Rocky, you know, get back in there, slugger, you can do this, and here's the missing stuff. Your father really did love you, Tony. Your father loved you, and he did all these things for you, and okay, that only makes sense if you then give him the shit that he needs to actually cure himself. If Tony throws it to the side and finds it somewhere else, that whole scene made no fucking sense and was pointless.
I just love that you at least flat out. I know you loathe this show with every fiber of your being, but allow me to dangle its nutsack on your forehead anyway.
Well, anytime I get to teabag you, you know, it makes the show, you know, that much more enjoyable.
Oh, don't worry, Mandated One. I'm going to tag you back. I will get you.
Oh, please. You who have embarrassed me on the show so many times by yelling no at me in your sing-songy voice. If I don't get one in every once in a while, it feels like a bullying relationship.
Oh, come on. I have never willfully bullied you. I've had fun with it because some of our listeners have dug it. And also, yeah, quite frankly, I got a huge hard-on for John C. McGinley and Scrubs.
That being said, we can talk about this more, and I'll let you have the floor. But that is literally my only gripe with this movie, because everything else, I know everyone like argues like, oh, they shoehorned. Nothing else felt shoehorned in. Everything else made sense. Everything else follows. I got what Whiplash was trying to do, Mickey Rourke's character. The only other real issue I had with it was that Justin Hammer was a retard. Like, he's the most effective villain ever.
You know what? The thing is, I really liked Whiplash, and I actually thought that he was horribly, horribly underused. If there was anything that I liked about the way they set up the villains, it's that thematically they had an interesting idea that was different from the first movie. In the first movie, the whole idea was that Tony came up with just conjured this brilliant creation from nothing, practically from the ether for all intents and purposes, and wanted to use it to legitimately create something else instead of destroy something else. And Stain wanted to use it as just another war machine, just another destroyer. In this movie, you have a bit of a mutation of that idea in that you have two characters, the Gary Shandling congressman character and Sam Rockwell's character, who just want to kind of wield this technology without really understanding it or without really having earned it. They want to, it's not so much that they want to stand on the shoulders of the giant, it's that if the giant won't give them the highest fruit that only he can reach, well, damn it, what they're going to do is they're going to wait until the giant has got the fruit in his hands. They're going to kick the giant square in the jimmy, and then when he's bent over, then they're going to stand on his back. And try to see how high he can reach.
I think a more accurate way of saying that would be wait for the giant to fall asleep and then stand on him. Because that's kind of what happens
here.
Tony is so distracted by his own demise that he can't stop the one thing he was trying to prevent in the first place, which was other people taking his shit.
Yeah, I mean, either or, I just happen to, you know, like to amuse with the idea of a couple of obnoxious little runts smacking a giant in the dick, but potato, potato. But, I mean, I like the fact that it's all kind of thrown in there, in both in parallel and in contrast with Whiplash, who you know, kind of through his father has seen a lot of these brilliant ideas that the Starks ultimately co-opted, taken and commandeered and twisted and all of it done without any credit whatsoever being given to one of the true pioneers of it. So it's really kind of muddling a lot of the shades of gray along the way. And that's what makes it interesting. The only problem is that really the most formidable villain in all this, like I said, there's no other way to put it. He really gets cast aside. It's like watching the way that Bane gets treated in a lot of Batman adaptations. I mean, here's a character that is every bit as brilliant a tactician in many ways as Bruce Wayne, that is by no means stupid and actually goes forward with a very well thought through, sound but simple plan, and actually really kind of wins most of the battles in Nightfall right up until Bruce manages to heal and because DC and Batman fuck you, that's why, he kind of assumes the cowl again and ends up kind of coming out ahead after all.
But let's take a time out for plot for a second, because I get what you're saying, and I think it's a valid point, but that's because the villain isn't the real issue in this movie. The real issue is Tony's, and this has been highly criticized by people, and I want to compare it to the discussion that's happening right now with the Avengers and Age of Ultron. This movie is about Tony dying. If you can sum it up in one sentence, Tony is dying. The thing that he built to save his life is now killing him. And he can't, for the life of him, fix it. So he is trying to come to terms with the fact that he doesn't have that much longer left before the shrapnel in his chest kill him. And he's coming unglued. You know, he wants to run away with Pepper, and just have fun. And he's not, you know, and he's giving away all of his stuff, and he's putting Pepper in charge of the company. You know, and he wants to spend the last few remaining moments left on this planet unburdened with all of this stuff. And along the way, someone is trying to kill him. Okay, and that's really what he's doing. So the main villain in this thing is actually Tony himself, and that's unfortunately why Mickey Rourke gets kind of short shrift in this thing. The other part of why he gets short shrift is because they have to spend time with Justin Hammer's character, who is the other villain, but, you know, we'll get to that a little bit later. People hated the fact that they wrote the movie this way, and I don't understand why. I think it added a gravity to the character. I think it added a gravity to the movie that Marvel needs every once in a while. I don't understand why people watch these movies and go, well, you know, they put something really serious. They put, you know, a man struggling with his own imminent death. Well, that's no fun. I just want to see Tony Stark shoot stuff. You know, like, people are saying, oh, the Age of Ultron, not as much fun as the first movie. First of all, the first movie was crap. Second of all, why are we as a public, why are we as comic book fans who have watched some of the grimmest things ever captured on a page, now going into the movies and expecting nothing but fluff and nothing, you know, and nothing but mindless action instead of some serious things at work? If anything, I think Marvel should be more embracing these ideas in their movies and not running away with them. But, you know, but you do. You get people out there, like, they don't want to see Tony struggling with his own demise. They don't want to see the Avengers struggling with, you know, with what is their role in the universe and, you know, and how do they deal with the fact that they're so overpowered in a world that, you know, that they can so easily destroy. That sort of thing.
It drives me crazy. They don't want to see any focus on Black Widow's relationship with Bruce Banner.
Yeah, then there's that.
These coughs make the damnedest noises. Cough. Fuck you, neckbeard. Cough.
So it's like we can't have nice things, you know, because you can't have it both ways.
No.
You can't have 2 hours of fluff, and then complain that there's no gravitas to it. There's no heft. There's no three dimensional characters. You asked for a porno, okay? That's what you're asking for. You're asking Marvel to make porno, just scene after scene of stuff getting blown up, you know, and that is supposed to be fun. I, however, want to watch a motion picture where it deals with people. So I love the idea that Tony is dying in the second one, and he's dying by the hand of the thing that he created to save himself in the first place. What irony, you know?
Look, and the fact is, these movies, they are products of their time. That is what they are. And quite frankly, the time that they're a product of is a time in comics where, yeah, they have evolved past just simply stuff goes boom. It has moved beyond that. They have moved into stuff. And quite frankly, both labels have. Both labels have done that.
Well, DC has gone insane. DC
well, no,
apparently...
Okay, that's good, though. Because here's what I would point out about DC. Okay, you want to see nothing but a bombastic, ridiculous, illogical clash of the titans, just with no real mind toward human element or actual human emotion or developing the characters as resembling actual people. Okay, fucking go watch a DC movie. That's what you're going to get. That is what you have always gotten with DC. DC makes gods, Marvel makes people, is the difference. You want to go watch stuff go splat, boom, crash, kapow? Okay, keep up on all the updates for Suicide Squad. I guarantee you, that's what you're going to get. God help you if you actually want to. Go sit through the absolute turd muffin that's going to be Batman versus Superman, not Justice League. Because I guarantee you, you will get dark and brooding and heavy-handed pseudo-commentary covered in delicious delusions of depth and morose navel-gazing and, oh, God, fuck so very much of it. On the other hand, if you want to see movies that are about people who are actually learning to cope with having exceptional abilities and superpowers and technology, well, here you go. Here's Marvel. But know what you are getting into. I remind some of these people, okay, the kind of movies you're talking about wanting to see, you got an entire decade of comics that was centered on that kind of storytelling. It was called the 90s. You know what? It fucking utterly sucked. In retrospect, just about every single aspect of it, including the fact that it inflicted the overexposed Deadpool virus on the world, came from that period. When, yes, that was what you got. What I believe Alyssa Jones and Chasing Amy called the big guns, big tets, big tits model of comics. Okay, go sit and masturbate into your pile of Rob Liefeld books. That's not what that's not what Marvel is. That has never really been, well, okay, with a few exceptions, I won't say never, because there are a few dark chapters we don't speak of. But, I mean, it's like, at this point, what exactly are you expecting? And quite frankly, you can't really make either side happy anymore. You can't make a lot of the comic fans happy because, yeah, sorry, you're not getting 2.5 hours of explosion porn. On the other hand, you can't make a lot of the critics happy because they're saying, this isn't following conventional movie storytelling norms, and they're not really making movies. They're just making chapters in a bigger saga. Mm-hmm. No shit, Sherlock. That's what almost every comic is. It's a chapter in a greater saga. And that's what Marvel is making. They're making adaptations of comics. Get out of your box and try appreciating it for what it is before you lambast some of this stuff a little bit unfairly. Okay,
but I would tell you that many of the movies do follow. And I'm not disagreeing with you, because I think the critics out there don't really understand what they're watching. But I would say that the movies, for the most part, follow good movie structure. The problem with Iron Man 2, like I said, is that while the rest of it was fine, you know, how we got from A to Z in Iron Man 2 was perfectly fine, except for right in the middle, where you set something up, you didn't pay it off, and then you threw something else out there from left field. And even the thing you threw out there from left field was so convoluted and idiotic that people spent the rest of the movie laughing at it. You know, but the rest of the movie, you know, look, the rest of the movie makes sense. But take away, if you want to take away the closest adaptation you're ever going to get to Demon in a Bottle, unfortunately, you know, out of the movie. Okay, so now Tony's not dying. So what is left? Okay, Vanko wants revenge on Stark for the way that his family treated Vanko's family. So he makes his own arc reactor, creates the Whiplash costume, attempts to kill Tony, misses, gets put in prison. Justin Hammer wants to build Iron Man suits for the military, and the military wants Tony Stark's suit, and he won't give it to him. So Justin Hammer breaks Vanko out, says, build me Iron Man suits. He says, okay, he'll do that, and along the way he strings Justin Hammer along long enough for him to hatch a devious plot. That he's, you know, he'll build drones that he can control for the purposes of killing Tony, and he'll build his own souped-up Whiplash suit for the purposes of killing Tony. In the meantime, Justin Hammer does get a hold of an Iron Man suit, soups it up, creates the War Machine thing, and Vanko takes control of that too for the purposes of killing Tony. He hatches his plot. He goes after Tony. Tony saves War Machine. They defeat him. End of story. It's not that hard to understand, nor is it that a terrible story. You know, you have a devious villain, you know, backstabbing another villain in order to exact revenge on, you know, on his archenemy. I don't know how much more straightforward I could have possibly said that. And I would have been fine if that's all the movie was. I think it would have been a little hollow. But if at the end of the day, Tony Stark isn't struggling, you know, to live, and that's all he has to deal with is everybody wants my stuff. Okay, not tremendously strong or interesting, but I'll take it. I thought it made the movie a lot more interesting that Tony spends half of it trying to avoid dying. But that's the part that everyone hates. And that's, you know, and that's what I say. We just can't have nice things, you know, in the Marvel Universe.
Well, but again, though, that's kind of the thing that I like about it, though. I like the fact that the heroes are in a state of jeopardy and that Marvel isn't afraid to make them vulnerable.
No, I agree.
Yeah, I mean, if there's one thing that DC, after all, has cocked up repeatedly, it's that basically the most immortal, godlike, infallible creature apparently in every realm of existence is fucking Batman.
So, in the interest of time, I want to talk a little bit about Sam Rockwell's portrayal of Justin Hammer. very different from the comic books. Much younger. Kind of plays him as a. My problem with the way Justin Hammer was written, and he's the only character that I have a major problem with in this movie, I thought Mickey Rourke's portrayal of Whiplash / Crimson Dynamo was just fine. I don't like it when the villain is a complete dork. You know, the villain should be giving the hero agita throughout the entire movie, so that at the end the payoff is, you know, when this hero finally trumps over the villain, you know, there is a payoff there. You know, you finally, the long-awaited triumph of the good guy. When you make your bad guy an incompetent boob, whose inventions are falling apart and looks like a schmuck, you know, the reporter's trying to do a thing on him, Tony upstages him. It's like, okay, at what point was Justin Hammer ever a threat to Tony? So I understand, you know, Sam Rockwell did the best he could with that part, but the only time he actually seems like a functional human being capable of doing anything is when he's unveiling all of his weapons to Don Cheadle, who takes over for Terrence Howard in this movie as Colonel James Rhodes. And, you know, he's going through the entire weapons display, and he actually seems like a fairly cool individual. And I enjoyed his delivery. You know, it's like, oh, not disco enough for you? Here's this. You know, and then at the end of it, he's like, so you got to give me something here. I can't read you at all. You know. But then even then, they undermine him at the end of the movie because, you know, the thing that he sells him at the end, you know, this missile, that this miniature missile, you know, that's supposed to be the Heartbreaker or whatever the fuck it's called, then doesn't work. And like, oh, Hammer. Like, okay, why even have him in the movie then? He was never a threat to Tony. He doesn't do, you know, he gets duped by Whiplash. He's, you know, and then at the end of it, he gets arrested. You are a worthless villain. And for people who criticized him, that's about the only thing I agreed with, was that he was worthless and not a worthy foe for Tony in this movie the way that he was written. They should have written him in a way where he was an actual threat to Tony, so that when Tony finally got back on track again, you know, he could actually redeem himself. But he doesn't have to do that because Hammer's an asshole.
Which was one of the really great improvements of having Guy Pearce in the third movie.
Yes, they corrected it in Iron Man 3, but. You know, that's my biggest problem with Iron Man 2, with Justin Hammer and the giant Easter egg in the fucking, you know, the Easter egg in the diorama. God, that annoys me. Every time I watch that scene, lose the trees, lose the path. Oh, look, I've discovered a new element.
Although, you know, when you look at the casting and you see that Tony's dad was Roger Sterling, all of a sudden, a lot of things about Tony suddenly start to make sense.
All right, anything else on Iron Man 2?
Since my Mad Men joke apparently fell on deaf ears, nope, I got nothing.
Sorry, I don't watch Mad Men. If you brought up The Wire, I'd have been right there with you. There's more people talking over each other in this movie, which I really hate. But other than that, I actually enjoy Iron Man 2, except for the parts that I've already spent enough time talking about. The introduction of the Scarlet Witch, not the Scarlet Witch, the introduction of the Black Widow in this is fine. You know, I think people complained, they were just trying to shove characters into this thing, you know, so that we can get to the Avengers. But if the characters actually do something and play a role, it makes sense. Yeah, like Scarlett Johansson's character actually did stuff and made sense, and I don't understand why people like complained about it, but they did. All right.
Okay.
So my question
to that would be, okay, quick, go through the other Marvel Phase 1 movies. By all means, pick out one where she would have fit better.
Oh, I'll go one better for you. If you want to talk about a character that was shoehorned in for no good reason, and then, you know, just so they could throw him into the Avengers and you would have at least some inkling of who he was. How about Hawkeye in Thor?
Oh, God. Oh, they... My, oh, my. Okay, yeah, that is one where they probably realized, oh, shit, we had plans to try to squeeze this guy into the Avengers, and a standalone movie with him is going to flop something fierce because nobody neither knows nor gives a shit about Hawkeye. Golly gee, where are we going to shove him? Hey, I know, let's shove him straight up Thor's ass.
And then have him not do anything. He doesn't even fire an arrow.
He's just kind of there for a quick little split-second cameo. You know, I watched, I actually watched Winter Soldier last night for the first time. And one of the things I can appreciate about that is kind of the thrift of it, and that everything that's in there feels like it's in there for a reason, and it feels like it's in there because it's building to something bigger. That isn't going to show, that is only going to be kind of hinted at in this movie, but that's going to become a very, very big deal later on.
Right.
I'm also going to preface this by pointing out I have not seen Ultron yet. I'm doing it this weekend. This has just been kind of a crazy whirlwind week for me too. So I just flat out ran out of time. So.
I apologize if I've spoiled any of the movie for you.
Well, No. I've had a very select few things spoiled anyway, because the other day I got curious when the day's episode of Nerdist News focused on detailing what it was that Joss was forced to cut from Age of Ultron. So I had a couple things very slightly spoiled by that, and I mean very, very, very vaguely, because God bless those good people. They did their best not to kind of go into detail as much as possible. But it isn't like I've had the... Well, and also I've kind of heard a little bit that apparently, as I said, there's a huge, massive online baby fit going on, wherein people like toddlers with shit diapers absolutely went ballistic on Joss Whedon to the point that he pretty much said, fuck this noise, to the internet and just abandoned Twitter on the whole thing. You know, so I know that a lot of that goes back to some real furor apparently over the way that Black Widow was used in the movie, which I've heard some people explain to me in as spoiler-free a way as possible. To put it succinctly, well, no shit, she was used that way. She was fucking pregnant.
Yeah, that's pretty much it.
Yeah, basically, like, well, what did you goddamn want them to do? The woman was like, I think about like 2 or 3 months along or so when she was shooting the movie already.
Well, not to go off on a complete tangent here, but when you think about the original lineup of the Avengers, what an overpowered group that is. So, you know, starting with the Hulk, right? The strongest human being on the planet. The angrier he gets, the stronger he gets, and he can crack the planet in half if he really wanted to. Then you have Thor, and you have Iron Man, and then you have Captain America. And really all you need is those four. Those four can pretty much take down anything on Earth. And so for the ride, you've then got Hawkeye the Archer, and then last but not least, the Black Widow, who they even say, like, in the first Avengers movie, they're like, when did you turn into a soldier? You're a spy. You know, like, she has even less purpose in the Avengers, really, than the Wasp did. You know, at least the Wasp had a power of some sort. You know, she's apparently just a chick in a leather outfit. So it's like, you know, I'm not unhappy they didn't do more with her. What the hell was she going to do?
Well, which is a shame, because actually there is a little more with her origin story that you could do. Excuse me. And that I hope down the line that they will seriously think about doing. But, man, you know, the way you introduced her and the way you had the first movie structured, okay, yeah, you're right. There was really very little that she could do. And in this one, I mean, again, I mean, what are you going to do with a character who pretty much right before she's set to start shooting finds out when the actress finds out she's pregnant? I mean, you got to make your way around that somehow.
Give her a love story with the Hulk.
Yeah, there's that. And, you know, and again, and maybe I'll change my mind once I actually see the movie, but just hearing about this on the surface, I don't have a problem with it.
No, neither do I. This is another case where we can't have nice things. But
you know what? If you don't mind me painting with broad strokes here for a second, I swear, when it comes to comic books, if it's not the ridiculous MRAs and meninists that are going to ruin things, it's going to be the overly alarmist feminists.
Yeah.
Not the ones who actually have good points, but just the ones who are determined that they're going to think like a hammer and every single goddamn thing in their sight is a nail.
All right, let's talk about Iron Man 3 here. Iron Man 3 exists in the
way. Yeah, we got off track.
And it's great in that, you know, if you can criticize the phase one for anything, and God knows people do. I know of one particular reviewer who has gone on record saying he absolutely hates Marvel Studios. But it seemed like it was rushed to the Avengers. And while individually there are movies that I enjoy, I enjoy The Incredible Hulk, I enjoy Captain America the First Avenger, Thor, I think missed the point a little bit. I mean, I enjoy it for what it is, but I still feel like there was more they could do with that movie that they didn't. And that one, if of all of them, that one the most felt like hurry up and get to the Avengers. Phase two, now that you know who these characters are and we've gotten to the Avengers, actually take some time and let the characters sort of exist in their own universes before bringing them back again. And so that's sort of the beauty of Iron Man 3. It's the last of the Tony Stark solo movies. You know, now he starts to become an integral part of other people's stories. Age of Ultron and then Civil War, which is a Captain America movie. But what I really love about Iron Man 3, what I thought was a great take on the character, was they take him out of the events of the Avengers and they say, okay, you carried a nuke into space and then fell through a wormhole and had to be saved by the Hulk. You know, you had to go out and fight an alien army and you nearly died. And that has an effect on his psyche. He ends up with post-traumatic stress disorder and he starts having these massive anxiety attacks. He also starts to sort of overcompensate for his fear that, and this becomes a big part of his character both then and in Age of Ultron and going forward into Civil War. Tony Stark has a real fear that and he says it in Age of Ultron, it doesn't matter how many arms dealers they take down, the real threat comes from above. The real threat, and he's prescient because we all know what's coming, it's Thanos and the Infinity War. The real threat, but even if you leave that out, you've got Skrulls, you've got all these other alien beings that exist in the Marvel Universe that take turns attacking the Earth. And he knows it, and he fears it, and he's trying to figure out what he can do to stop it. And so the first leg of this is the first way of sort of coping with this anxiety is he builds an army of suits. And when we see Tony again, he's working on a suit that can come to him by essentially using telekinesis. He injects himself with the stuff, and then he can kind of call things using his mind. And that's where we find him. Starts with a flashback, and this is where they brought in the other terrorist group in the Marvel Universe, AIM, AIM. Advanced Idea Mechanics. This is where we meet Guy Pearce's character, Aldrich Killian, and they bring up the Extremis virus, which right now, just as a side note, in the Hulk comic book, Iron Man used the Extremis to save Hulk from when he was shot in the head, and he became yet a new version of the Hulk called Doc Green, but that's besides the point. Aldrich Killian is working with Maya Hansen, and they want to develop this Extremis thing, which is basically something that people can use to regenerate body parts and heal themselves, and it also has the advent of giving them superpowers. This is also again about demons and and creating problems, and so where we find Tony is in a flashback, and they pitch this idea to him, and he leaves the guy stranded on the roof while he goes and parties with Maya Hansen, and so once again he has set somebody up to want to take revenge on him. Aldrich Killian shows up years later at Stark Industries and tries to sell his idea to Pepper Potts. Pepper Potts says no, not today. And that sort of sets the plot in motion for them to concoct these various plots to get at Tony. Meanwhile, we have another issue where, and this is what I want to talk about real quick because it was the most hotly debated thing in the movie. We have Ben Kingsley playing the Mandarin because you can't get away with unless you actually get Mr. Fuji. Someone's going to get upset. So,
and what would be wrong with that?
Mr. Fuji with a handful of magic rings.
You're not invisible against my Yokozuna.
Yeah, exactly. So instead, just typical Hollywood. They take away a part from what could have gone to an Asian guy, and they give it to a white man, and he. And he kind of, it's a cross between like Osama bin Laden and Malcolm X, I guess. And he's out there making videos and blowing stuff up, and so this is a huge problem, and they want Iron Man to deal with this as well. In the midst of all of this happening, Happy follows the trail of one of the Extremis guys. And the Extremis guy goes boom and nearly kills Happy.
Yep.
Which gets Tony then saying, "You want me? I live here. Come get me." And of course, he puts Pepper in harm's way again. They blow up Tony's house. They nearly kill Tony. Tony ends up in Tennessee. And that's where the movie kind of slows down to a crawl so that Tony can. Become Batman and deal with a detective story. But along the way, he also, with the aid of this kid, starts to deal with the PTSD in a very real way. Because up to this point, he was sort of avoiding it by building Iron Man suits. And now, bereft of Jarvis, bereft of all of his suits, he's just, a man in his anxiety and talents. And that's what the kid reminds him of. He refers to himself as the mechanic, and the kid says, "Well, if you're a mechanic, then go build something." And Tony says, "Right." So he builds himself a set of weapons. He figures out where the Mandarin is, and he goes after him. And that's when he finds out, ta-da, it's the Mandarin twist, da-da-da, ha-da-da-da-da-da. The Mandarin twist, ladies and gentlemen. Turns out the Mandarin was a made-up character being played by a British actor named Trevor.
You know what? Here's the thing. My problem with this didn't come necessarily from the whitewashing of the Mandarin. I understand you have to get around a way to make this character not look fucking ridiculous on the big screen. I get that. God knows we don't want another instance of a Marvel villain becoming a low-pressure system over Cleveland. On the other hand, you had a good idea. You had a good idea of the Mandarin being this shadowy terrorist mastermind. I was actually on board with that for most of the movie. Then came the reveal. And I just sat there at a loss for words that didn't begin or end with fuck. And it just didn't get any better.
I disagree. I'm with you in that I could have gone, look, if this was a choose-your-own-adventure, I'm 50-50 on either road. On the road where that's exactly what it was, and he's your main villain, and Aldrich Killian is sort of his right-hand man, the Darth Vader to his emperor, and he's out there blowing things up and whatever else.
He wasn't,
you know, and maybe
Darth Vader. He was Jar Jar goddamn Binks. He was a fucking retarded-looking handmaiden. The Queen Amidala.
Let me get there. If the road that they went down was that there was no twist, he really was this malevolent guy blowing things up and trying to kill the president and all that. Okay, that's fine. I'm with you. I enjoyed that interpretation of the Mandarin. But I'm also okay with this idea of the writers of this movie playing around with the idea of media. I like the Wag the Dog concept. If you've ever seen the movie Wag the Dog, the president has some sort of a scandal. I think it's a sex scandal. They were making fun of Bill Clinton. And so, and just like in real life, people criticize Bill Clinton because he ended up doing some sort of military action close to the Monica Lewinsky scandal, to the point where people were referring to the bombings as Monica missiles. Wag the Dog, the movie with Robert De Niro, similar thing. They invent a war so as to get pressure off of the president for a scandal that he was involved in. So, you know, in the sense that, you know, they're playing around with that idea of using media to manipulate people and creating a character, you know, to sort of coalesce opinions and attitudes or whatever towards something. But really, you know, the guy behind the whole thing is Aldrich. I was actually fine with that. I got it. I understood the point of it. God bless him. I'm going to use him as an example, though. Gavin Napier of the Casual Heroes is pretty much the most, like, hardcore. If it's not an exact, like, mimicking of the comic books, then it's not right and it sucks. This is the guy who last year didn't like Days of Future Past because he didn't like the fact that all the Sentinels were Nimrods. Okay? And this year his big problem is that it's something about the Vision, Vision's eyes, and that Ultron has lips. Whatever. I'm just not that much of a stickler, okay? I don't care. You know, these characters are meaningful to me in that I enjoy them and I want to see them in motion pictures, but I'm open-minded enough to appreciate adaptations and creative license. And with that being said,
I'm not Gavin, but suck my indestructible ironmonger. That twist was stupid.
Well, you can think the twist is stupid, but I think it's stupid for, you know, because it isn't the comic book, to me is not a good argument. It's stupid because whatever your reasons are, I'm willing to listen to.
This is one time I'm not going to say, it's stupid because it's not the comic book. I'm fine with that. Sometimes you get away from the source material and you actually end up with a better idea. Thank merciful Christ they didn't include Skull Cowboy in The Crow. That was actually just fine. In this case, I'm calling it goddamn stupid because it was goddamn stupid.
Okay. Now, what you can't just say it's stupid. What's stupid about it?
For starters, you took a villain that actually I was kind of invested in. I was really actually interested in seeing some more of him and seeing him develop a little bit more toward the end of the movie. And on top of that, one who is played by one of Hollywood's all-time great legends. And you turned him into goddamn Russell Brand. What?
But don't you understand the whole concept of, like I said before, of, you know, them playing around with the idea of using media? You know, it's the old Remember the Main. This was the living embodiment of Remember the Main.
Oh, yes, goddammit. I get the whole concept of, we're going to play with them through the media, and it's bait and switch. We're manipulating their opinions and all that. And yes, I remember Wag the Dog is an awesome movie, but now you're reminding me of, as much as Iron Man 3 isn't as bad on a second viewing as I thought it was, of something better that I would rather be watching. You could have set up something awesome where this was Tony caught in the middle between a legitimate terrorist madman and Killian, and had it be a whole interesting triple threat match kind of thing. That could have been kind of fun, and it might have actually managed to be more effective than when you had Tony versus Whiplash versus functionally retarded Sam Rockwell. But instead, it just ends up with this whole asinine, out of nowhere twist that makes me feel almost like, instead of Ben Kingsley, like the Mandarin should have been played by fucking Jack Black or Ben Stiller.
Oh, God, that would have been terrible.
You know? That was how I felt about it. And again, this isn't even me being necessarily a comic book stickler, even though one of the kind of neat things about the Tony versus Mandarin rivalry was the fact that it was technology versus mysticism. That was the interesting part of it. I realize you can't render the Mandarin on the big screen the same way he did in the comics and expect any reaction except for uproarious laughter and screams of, oh, fuck that.
But yeah, I hear you.
This to me was right up there with how I played the first few hours of Batman Arkham Origins, really invested in this whole story of the Black Mask putting a contract out on Batman's head and thinking, wow, this is interesting. I'm actually kind of getting involved with some other villains here. It's going in a fresh direction. And then 3, 2, 1, nope, it's been the Joker the whole time. Womp womp. I don't like bait and switch unless it's done really, really fucking well.
Okay.
This was not done really fucking well.
Here's where I'll agree with you. This is the one point that I think you can distill this down to. At the end of the day, the reveal didn't serve the plot in any way, shape, or form. It was a twist for the sake of a twist. And you could talk, you know. And as I said, I'm defending it on the grounds, you know, of Wag the Dog, but even still, I don't know if as I think about the movie, I don't know if that got you any further down the line than not having it there in the first place. Like, I don't, like, okay, so you're creating the character to do this and that and the other thing, but, you know, people are going to hate me for this example, but at least the Emperor created the war between the Separatists and the Old Republic so that he could use it to get himself more power and eventually become the Emperor. That was the whole point of the war. You know, the war was the Trojan horse that allowed him to become Emperor. I'm not entirely sure what the Mandarin's purpose was in terms of getting Guy Pearce anything that he wanted. Because on the one hand, he seemed to want to just kill Tony. Okay, he wanted his extremist thing out there, and he wanted to kill Tony, and he didn't seem to have much else going on at the time. So I don't understand, like, were the bombings supposed to draw out Iron Man just so he could kill him? Because that seems rather elaborate for such a small purpose. And then why try to sell Stark Industries the extremist thing anyway? Like, that's the problem with that. That's the biggest problem I have with Iron Man 3. is that the motives aren't clear and things are just happening for the sake of happening. Now, I like the happenings in the same way that I like watching, you know, art. Okay? I can look at a pretty thing and say, ooh, pretty. And I feel like I have said that before very recently. But if that's all it is, that's not good storytelling. And so while Iron Man 3 is definitely a fun movie to watch, it definitely has some plot problems. It's probably got the weakest plot of the first two movies. By far.
Which is sad, because actually the theme of it is really pretty interesting. Tony dealing with his PTSD. I was on board with that part.
Why were people more on board with him dealing with his PTSD and not on board with him dealing with dying?
Hey, I was fine with both of them.
I'm sure you were, but you know, I'm asking a rhetorical question here, I guess. But that's actually, I mean, in the interest of time, that's kind of all I have to say about Iron Man 3. Was that the plot's a bit thin, and the stuff they're doing, you know, didn't serve the story in any way, shape, or form that mattered. I would have also liked to have seen them utilize Pepper Potts' rescue. I wish she had had her own suit of armor that they could have called upon. The Operation House Party protocol, and then the clean slate was fun to watch. That whole scene where he's jumping in and out of suits is a fun way to end the movie, and then curing himself of the shrapnel in the heart was a good way to end it. But it's kind of hard to say, like, oh, well, that's the end of Tony's story. Tony's story was really just beginning. there's so much more for Tony to do. Last words on Iron Man and the trilogy at large, and then we'll get out of here.
Stuff go boom.
Well said. All right, what do you got going on this week?
I'm going to make coffee, and then I'm going to continue watching this Let's Play of BioShock Infinite. And then I think we have movies to watch for another Long Road to Ruin. Although it occurs to me that actually what I'd really like for us to do at some point, we should really do almost like a special edition apart from Long Road to Ruin that kind of picks up with an idea we had a long time ago of looking at the DC animated series from kind of Batman the Animated Series onward. Because that seemed like a fun idea, and we, unfortunately... Well, okay, it was my fault. Kind of had to abandon that just as it was getting going. But I was thinking we should revisit that at some point.
At some point. Maybe when we get out of the summer blockbuster season, because our next show, we will be looking at the Mad Max trilogy. Fury Road comes out a week from tomorrow. I will be reviewing it the following Wednesday with Robert Winfrey, barring any unforeseen calamity. And then on Thursday, we will be reviewing the trilogy that begets Fury Road, The Road Warrior, Mad Max, and Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome. So that's what's up next here on the Long Road to Ruin. If you haven't had an opportunity yet, check out the source material. This week, we talked about Demon in a Bottle. Jason Teasley, Benjamin Cologne, and Robert Winfrey reviewed Age of Ultron, because unfortunately I was unable to. I was in the hospital with my daughter, and I chose not to leave the hospital, instead wanting to be with her. So, unfortunately, I was not able to review the Age of Ultron.
Don't we also have 4 Terminator movies to watch in the fairly near future?
Yes, I believe Terminator Genesis comes out. Wrong button. God damn it. Stupid computer. Terminator Genesis comes out July 1st. So the week after that, we will be, I'll be reviewing Terminator Genesis, and then on that Thursday, we will be looking at the first 3 Terminator movies. I'm not including Salvation. That was a piece of shit, and it doesn't count. It is the Superman Returns. of Terminator movies. And I don't count.
Your willfulness to dodge certain shitty movies just stuns me.
I like things in threes.
Bullshit! Fuck you! You know how many times I have actually had to say, Mark, I thought we've been over this before. We're leaving it at three movies per episode. Every time we do four per episode, things get too long. Oh, okay, hey, here's another quadrilogy. We're going to shove everything into 2 hours. I like things. No, you just like to avoid certain batches of awful.
So
you just like to avoid certain bad things.
Well, you know. What is there to talk about with Salvation? It sucked. It was terrible. Wouldn't you rather spend that time talking about the first three Terminator movies?
I'd rather spend that time talking about the first two Terminator movies.
Oh, there's so much to talk about with the third one. Are you kidding me? That's the plan there.
You know what? When you guys do the Summer Blockbuster Series edition where you talk about Terminator Genesis,
I may have to join you for that one just because, and this is, you're going to wonder why this is the thing that's bugging you of all the things about this impending turd. Why, since it's obviously, you know, a cyborg, meaning it's ageless, Why the T-800 all of a sudden looks like he's been left out in the desert sun too long?
He's old man River.
I want to hear the logical. I honestly don't get out to movies and theaters nearly as often anymore. This one, I'm tempted to go just because I want to hear that explained. Because the trailer has already ruined the movie for me.
I haven't even watched the trailer.
Then don't watch it before you go see it, because it spoils the surprise.
I'm trying to stay as far away from any more spoilers about this movie as possible.
You know what? I do that with a lot of movies all the time. I'm not going to fault you for that one. But upon seeing this trailer, that was the one that stuck in my craw. Was, I mean, whoa. You're a cyborg. You don't age. It doesn't happen, with the exception of obviously showing stuff like tears and battle damage. And I realize that, yes, Arnold, you know, this isn't the 80s or 90s anymore. But if you can't do some things right, don't do them at all. Otherwise, risk looking laughable for
Here's
all
my
the
theory.
Wrong reasons.
I have a theory here, and then we really must get going. Here's my theory. So a cyborg is living tissue over metal exoskeleton, yeah? Right? The living
Correct.
Tissue aged. The living tissue merely aged. I mean, you know, if you look at, like, a banana peel, right? A banana peel will go from green to yellow to brown, right? Because it ages.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have living tissue over the metal, wouldn't it follow that the tissue would age?
I wonder then how they're going to explain the dad bod that Terminator has got. Do cyborgs also gain beer guts as they get older? Is this also a thing?
In as it endeavored to become more human, it also put on weight so it would feel the human experience.
It had probably reached the conclusion that becoming more human is sorely overrated. fuck that stupid little biker trash kid that convinced me otherwise.
I want to see the Terminator kind of like walk on screen, scratch his ass, and burp and talk about the touchdown he scored in high school.
Okay, I would even go see that with a stupid misspelled subtitle.
All right.
Because apparently this is Terminator as produced by Fred Durst. We have to misspell something.
All right. Next Thursday, we took a bit of a hiatus because of various things, but next Thursday, the Metal Hammer of Doom is back. We'll be reviewing the new Corpacani. The day before that is the conclusion of the Daredevil series. We'll be looking at the last four episodes. So that'll be good. That'll be fun. Hopefully we'll actually have Pat Mullen on this one. He's promised to be on every episode. He's been on none of them.
Oh, Pat.
And I think that's it. I think, So next Wednesday, Daredevil. Thursday. Thursday is Metal Hammer of Doom, the new Corpacani. A week after that, Wednesday, we'll be reviewing Fury Road. And Thursday, we're looking at the Mad Max trilogy. So that's what's next on the Radulich Broadcasting Network over the next couple of weeks. Due to family issues, I was not able to record any casual Heroes WrestleCast this week, so I don't think they did one, to my knowledge. Maybe I'm wrong about that, but there isn't one as near as I can tell right now. So hopefully also next week you'll hear me on the casual Heroes WrestleCast as per usual. So, Sean, unless you got anything else, without further ado, what do I always play at the end of the show? It's been so long now, I forget like how.
You know what? It varies. We started off playing Clutch, and then you switched to the NFL on Fox theme, and then it was, I think it was one of the songs from the Muppet movie.
Mm-hmm. You know what?
Let's go out with some. You know, some AC/DC. You got Shoot to Thrill?
Should have loaded that up, but no. I've got the old Raw theme from the 90s. I got the Brock Lesnar theme. I got the Shield. I got Star Wars Disco.
Hard to go wrong with any of those, but you know what? Since it's looking like the giant T-Rex of the summer blockbuster season. No, it's not coming out in summer. It's coming out in winter. I was going to say, let's go with Star Wars.
I'll go with the classic. So for Sean Comer, this is your mandated reporter, Mr. Mark Adelaide, saying be well, be safe, and behave.
Bye-bye.